Bona tarda a tothom. Primer de tot, reitero les meves disculpes de fa mitja hora perquè he convocat l'acte mitja hora més tard del que preveuen les noves normes de la casa. Sí. Llavors, moltes gràcies per haver esperat el senyor cònsol general Nicoletti, al qual dono la benvinguda en aquest dijous europeu, el segon d'enguany. I és el dijous europeu dedicat, com fem cada sis mesos, a discutir la presidència del Consell de la Unió Europea al semestre anterior, és a dir, el segon semestre del 2014. Una cosa que potser ha espantat part del nostre públic habitual, o els assistents més que públic habituals, és el fet que farà la seva exposició inaugural o inicial en anglès, però amb transparències, és a dir, serà relativament fàcil de seguir. Després les preguntes, ell diu que se sent més còmode en anglès. Si alguna pregunta, perquè és complexa tècnicament, la volgués respondre en anglès, jo la traduiria, la seva resposta més aviat. I a l'inrevés, és a dir, vostès poden fer les preguntes de les intervencions després en català o en castellà, el castellà ell l'entén. Bé, això és el pròleg administratiu. Reitero doncs la benvinguda al cònsol general senyor Stefano Nicoletti, que és cònsol general des del 2 de setembre de 2013, vol dir que ha viscut les dues diades més mogudetes de la història recent com a cònsol general. He resumit, com sempre, el seu currículum al full de fets, molt succintament. Ell va començar la seva carrera diplomàtica l'any 94, ell és economista de formació, ha fet un màster a la Universitat Johns Hopkins a Baltimore, als Estats Units, ha entrat al servei diplomàtic l'any 94 i va passar els quatre primers anys a la Direcció General de Cooperació i Desenvolupament a Roma, abans de sortir cap a un país on el desenvolupament és important, que és la Índia. Va estar el primer secretari de l'oficina comercial italiana a l'ambaixada de Nova Delhi, a la Índia, i després va passar quatre anys a Berna, que és una mica les antípodes, suposo, des del punt de vista comercial i econòmic de la Índia, i va estar al cap de l'oficina comercial econòmica de l'ambaixada de Berna. Veuran que el currículum sempre surt al final, el seu ascens a l'escalafó, m'ha explicat fa un moment que això a l'escalafó no té res a veure amb la seva funció diplomàtica, actualment és cònsol general, però de fet el seu càrrec administratiu és conseller d'ambaixada. Jo demano perdó per la confusió que potser sorgeix quan es llegeix aquest currículum. Torno una mica al seu currículum com a diplomàtic. De Berna va tornar a Roma i es va fer càrrec de la primera oficina de l'Oficina de Cooperació Econòmica i Financera Multilateral, que té a veure amb tot el que són organismes internacionals com l'OCDE, molt més complicats que la nostra estimada Unió Europea. És a dir, que penso que ha tingut unes experiències que el qualifiquen especialment per parlar avui de la Unió Europea i del semestre de la presidència italiana, la dotzena presidència italiana al llarg de la història. De Roma va tornar a sortir, va anar cap a París i va estar a la representació italiana davant de l'OCDE i va ser membre del Consell Executiu de l'ESA. L'ESA és aquest organisme europeu que llança coets, no? Que és una cosa que econòmicament és una cosa que diem molt sovint, no, no està l'economia per llançar coets. El senyor Nicoletti ho ha fet com a membre del Consell Executiu. I de París ha vingut doncs a Barcelona i és el cònsol general. Benvingut, senyor Nicoletti. Your presentation will be in English, so like I said, if you want me to translate any bits of it, just let me know. Mm-hmm. Otherwise, we just do it like this in English, and then afterwards, the questions I said, I would translate if there's any reply or any intervention in English, in Catalan, okay?
Okay. Buona tarda, buenas tardes, buonasera, good evening. I would like, first of all, to thank a lot Stefan Rading for inviting me to make this assessment of the main results of the Italian presidency. First of all, a word of caution. I'm here, as he was saying, as Consul General of Italy in Barcelona. So obviously what I'll be able to deliver during this conference to all of you is a reported view of the European presidency of Italy, not an interview of it, since I'm not the Italian representative to the EU or a diplomat that has been living through the 6 months of the European presidency in Brussels. That's obvious, but it's important to specify it at the beginning of this chat, because it gives better the perspective that I will give to the overall presentation. I was thinking to start from the very beginning, stating with the help of some slides which were the stated priorities of the Italian presidency. Basically, the main priorities of the Italian presidency were the first pillar dealing with a job-friendly Europe and economic growth. A second pillar was revolving around the idea of the EU as an area of democracy, rights, and freedom. A third pillar was around the concept of the global role of the EU. With reference to the first pillar, a job-friendly Europe and economic growth, some of the main elements which were supposed to guide the work of the Italian presidency are to put job and growth at the heart of the EU economic policy, full implementation of the Youth Employment Initiative, so the topic, the issue of employment and above all of employment of the young people, a relaunch of the Europe 2020 strategy, a deepening and strengthening of the European Monetary Union, the idea of fostering competitiveness in the EU, the realization of a single digital market, the promotion of an industrial renaissance, the attainment of a common EU position on climate and energy at the horizon 2030. Several issues dealing with the idea of retaking a perspective focused not so much on austerity, but rather on putting the European economy in motion. A second pillar is revolving around the idea of the EU as an area of democracy, rights, and freedom. Under this chapter, we can, for example, consider elements like how to obtain a well-functioning and effective European institutions, how to deal with issues like asylum, migration policy, the question of the external border management, how to deepen judicial cooperation, how to promote fundamental human rights protection, and the principle of non-discrimination, equal treatment. Finally, there is a third pillar dealing with the global role that the EU should play in a world context. Under that heading, we can consider issues like the external dimension of the migration policy, the progress in the enlargement process to promote peace, democracy, security in Europe, how to address regional challenges, both in the Mediterranean region, the transitional process in North Africa, in the Middle East, crises like those in Libya, Syria, Ukraine. Under this heading, there is also the question of the EU economic policy, how to reinforce, for example, strategic partnership, trade and investment negotiations like the ones that are undergoing with the US and Canada. There is also a chapter on the promotion of macro-regional strategies like the one dealing with the Adriatic region or the Alpine region. These are basically the stated objective, the stated goals with which the European the Italian presidency started during the month of July this year. Obviously, Italy has taken the opportunity of chairing the Council of the EU immediately after the European election, at the beginning of a new political cycle. And what has tried to do, basically, is to turn the ongoing anti-European tension in a common desire for change. Which is, I repeat this concept because I think that is quite central. Presently, there are a series of tensions within the EU for quite a number of reasons. How to be able to translate this tension, these different interests, in a common desire for change, with a sort of an hopeful type of feeling and perspective. During the semester, this message of a positive change was repeatedly given by our Prime Minister, Matteo Renzi, stressing altogether the need to establish a new way of doing politics in Europe. Obviously, this period of 6 months took place within a context of great challenges. At the same time, internal challenges and external challenges. Internal challenges because basically the economic situation in Europe is still very unfavorable. And that's a major challenge, how to put in motion again the European economy, but also external challenges with an international scenario which has been characterized by a great instability. So let's start with what the Italian presidency was able to obtain internally. I would characterize the main attainment as a new approach to the EU economic policy. Internally, the Italian presidency had to tackle the task to revamp growth by changing the direction of European policies, which were focused mainly on a budgetary discipline. On this basis, the idea of growth and investments are now, at the end of this period, newly at the center of the European debate. We can say that thanks to the Italian presidency's efforts, a vast consensus was reached on a new strategy and a new approach with regard to the EU economic policy. Growth stays weak, and in Italian views, the revival of growth and employment can only take place through a mix of measures to be implemented jointly and simultaneously by all different member states. These measures involve structural reforms, incentives to create jobs, policies to sustain both public and private investments with the support of accommodating monetary policies. The agreement that was reached by the ECOFIN Council on the 14th of October 2014 on measures in support of investment in Europe gave the real go-ahead to the creation of a task force co-chaired by the European Investment Bank on one side and the Commission on the other, with the participation of all member states, which is responsible of analyzing the main bottlenecks and obstacles to investment and of proposing practical solutions to overcome such impediments, so as to make the European Council decisions, which were then approved and adopted in December, more effective. Indeed, this task force will also in the future identify potentially viable investment projects to be realized both in the short and medium term. One of the first consequences of this new approach was the European Council agreement on the Juncker's investment plan to promote competitiveness, growth, and employment in Europe, which, as you all know, is looking to mobilize 315 billions of euros in public and private investments in the period 2015-2017. Another important element was centrality of active policies for employment. The Italian presidency highlighted the issue of active policies for employment, especially for the young people, at European level, especially on the occasion of the high-level conference on employment, which was held last October. On this occasion, the fight against unemployment took center stage, along with the fight against poverty and social exclusion. Another major area of achievement was the one of transparency and fight against tax evasion. The Italian presidency, in fact, focused on issues related to transparency and to the fight against fraud and tax evasion. Thanks to the efforts which were undertaken, the Council has reached an agreement to prevent the double non-taxation of the dividends among corporate groups stemming from hybrid financial arrangement. This bridged the gap which up until now has helped corporate groups to take advantage of inconsistencies between national tax rules in order to avoid paying taxes on some of the profits that were distributed within the group. Furthermore, a directive widening the mandatory automatic exchange of information among tax administration was also adopted. In addition to information on income arising from interest, the information on income arising from the sales of financial assets and dividends are now also exchanged, thus preventing the taxpayers from hiding capitals on taxable activities. That is very important, obviously, because the only way to reduce the fiscal pressure is to have all those who are supposed to pay taxes really paying taxes and paying taxes in the various countries where they are producing their income, which unfortunately was not the case, and was not the case also for some major multinational enterprises within Europe. Another area of interest of the European presidency is the one of the banking union and the regulation of financial markets. In this area, further steps were taken as regards the full implementation of the banking union. In particular, the European Central Bank, in collaboration with the European Banking Authority, completed the comprehensive evaluation of the balance sheet made up of an asset quality review and stress testing of banks under the single supervisory mechanism. This very important single supervisory mechanism by the European Central Bank became fully operational during the period of the Italian presidency on the 4th of October 2014. Coming now at the international scenario, we can say that on the international front, the Italian presidency had to address numerous instability scenarios, from the Russian-Ukrainian crisis to the emergence of ISIS, from the conflict in Libya to the spread of Ebola. A series of challenges have appeared at the European borders. These challenges require a European Union that is stronger and ever more capable of acting without hesitation. The Italian presidency has provided full support to the EU external action to ensure an effective EU response in all the main areas of crisis which arose in the European neighborhood. An extraordinary Foreign Affairs Council on Iraq was convened by the Italian presidency during the month of August, which provided political consensus regarding military support to the fight against ISIS by some member states. On the Russian-Ukrainian crisis, the Italian presidency, in particular by chairing the meetings, the numerous meetings of the COREPER, ensured a unified and coherent response, in particular on the sanctions issue. A renewed dialogue between Russia and Ukraine was also facilitated in the margins of the ASEM summit in Milan. Italy, in this area, acted as a sort of a moderator between the different European sensitiveness by trying to reconcile the rightful firm stance in favor of Ukraine's independence and territorial integrity with the need to maintain open a dialogue with Moscow by recalling the compliance with the Minsk agreements. Another important chapter is the one of the enlargement. It is true that within the EU, the enlargement process is experiencing a certain wariness. But in the vision of Italy, the expansion of the membership of the EU to the current 28 countries has been an exercise where Europe showed an extraordinary leadership. The Council adopted the conclusion on enlargement and association and stabilization process aimed at reaffirming the strategic role of the enlargement toward the Western Balkans and Turkey. This Italian presidency priority led to some concrete results, such as the opening of the four new negotiation chapters with Montenegro, the conclusion of the preparatory work for the opening of the first chapter of negotiation with Serbia, and progress towards opening of a new negotiation chapter dealing more with economic and monetary policy with Turkey. Also, in order to counteract potential trends moving away from the Ankara European process in the light of the events of the last month of 2014. The process of European integration of Albania, of the former Yugoslav Republic of Macedonia and Bosnia-Herzegovina was also supported. Finally, the European Council adopted the EU strategy for the Adriatic and Ionian region, which will focus especially on the areas of the blue economy, infrastructural and energy connectivity, environment and tourism. And this strategy represents an innovative platform of cooperation between four EU countries, namely Italy, Slovenia, Croatia, and Greece, and four non-EU countries, namely Albania, Montenegro, Bosnia-Herzegovina and Serbia. And now a very important chapter, I believe both for Italy and Spain, which is the management of migratory flows. The Italian presidency worked to better engage the European Union and the other member states in the management of migratory flows. Under our presidency, we agreed on three major guidelines at European level in this field. Number one, a reinforced management of external borders and a strengthening of Frontex. Number two, cooperation with third countries, which is absolutely unavoidable and key. Number three, an action at member states level for the reception of migrants and fingerprinting. The Italian efforts led to a renewed common understanding that all EU member states' external borders represent a common border. It seems something obvious, but is not really so whenever one has to discuss on how to do a division of labor in this field. The external borders of all EU member states should represent a common border of the EU. Against this backdrop, the first action line is linked to the launch of the Operation Trident, carried out under the auspices of a reinforced Frontex. The Council, in a jumbo meeting that was able to let intervening both the EU ministers for foreign affairs and for internal affairs, has stressed the importance of a greater integration between migration and development. That is to say, in between the internal and external dimension of the migration policies. And that by enhancing the dialogue with the countries of origin and transit. It is with this in mind that the Italian presidency has organized a series of ministerial meetings on migration issues. In particular, the fourth Euro-African Ministerial Conference with North and West African countries on migration and development within the context of the so-called Rabat process, and the first ministerial conference of the Khartoum process with the countries of East Africa. In a context of renewed attention towards the Mediterranean, the Italian presidency also launched the initiative Amici. Amici means friends in Italian, but it's also the acronym of a Mediterranean Investment Coordination Initiative. This initiative was endorsed by the Foreign Affairs Council, and it aims at providing a framework for investment and at rationalizing the existing tools for the Mediterranean area. Another very, very important chapter of our presidency was also the birth of new EU institutions, or the better saying, the transition between the old and the new EU institutions, which obviously has characterized the Italian semester and has reduced up to a certain extent also the legislative activity of the European Parliament during this period. Nonetheless, the transition did not compromise Italy's role. Indeed, one of the major results achieved by Italy has been its contribution to a timely and seamless institutional transition. The new EU Parliament started its operation from the 1st of July 2014, the Juncker Commission from the 1st of November, and the President of the European Council from the 1st of December. The agreement that was reached on the 30th of August between the head of states and government on the new appointment to the EU top position was actually facilitated by the Italian candidacy to the post of High Representative of the Union for Foreign Affairs and Security Policy, post that is also that of Vice President of the Commission, which, as you all know, was of an Italian, our former Minister of Foreign Affairs, Federica Mogherini. This candidature and the selection of Federica Mogherini in turn has paved the way for the main European political families and the members of the European Council to converge on the choice of the Polish Prime Minister Donald Tusk for the post of President of the European Council. Together with the action of identification of the new EU top leader, the Italian presidency has worked also in terms of improving the EU functioning. In order to mark the beginning of a new political and institutional cycle, the Italian presidency, during the General Affairs Council, has carried out a wide-ranging debate on the functioning of the EU, a sort of a check-up on the state of health of the EU, which revealed a number of elements concerning the institution, functioning, and unused margins of the Treaty of Lisbon. As an initial result, a real joint planning of the legislative activity of the Council, the Parliament, and the Commission was launched. Therefore, in the future, at least we hope, there will be a shared framework of strategic priorities, which is a significant advantage also in terms of effectiveness and transparency of the European activity. To this end, an ad hoc reflection group, which in the EU terminology is called Friends of the Presidency, was established within the Council with a mandate to make proposals to improve the functioning of the EU institutions. The Italian Presidency presented a report called Improving EU Functioning to the General Affairs Council with the aim of making the EU more democratic, effective, and rapid in terms of decision-making and of the implementation of jointly defined strategic priorities. We now come the core of one of the functions of the EU, which is in the area of trade policy. The Italian government believes that a rapid and successful conclusion of the negotiation on transatlantic trade and investment partnership with the United States represents one fundamental step to revitalize growth in Europe and will lead off to a second phase of globalization characterized by benefits that are distributed hopefully more evenly among the different areas of the world. In a framework of strong support to an agreement on the TTIP, the Italian presidency has brokered the agreement for the declassification of the directives for the trade and financial negotiation on TTIP. And by making the ongoing negotiation more transparent, this decision aimed at satisfying the public opinion's quest for more and opportune information. The Italian presidency also supported the negotiations with Canada, which were finalized during the semester but still await the Council political endorsement, as well as the progress of the negotiation with Japan, which has reached its seventh round. Moreover, A free trade agreement with Singapore was concluded, and in addition, the economic partnership agreement with the Economic Community of West African States was agreed upon, signed by Italy, and open for signing by other member states. In the field of climate and energy, the Italian presidency has worked for an agreement on the new 2030 framework for climate and energy. The objective was to achieve a consensus on an ambitious and advantageous strategy that can reach the long-term European goals on decarbonization, while striking at the same time a balance between objectives, commitments, and related costs. The agreement in this field that was reached by the European Council of 23rd and 24th of October represented a great success, thanks to the identification of the European goals in terms of emission reduction, -40%, renewable energies, +27%, and increased energy efficiency, +27%. Thanks to this accomplishment, the EU was able to take the lead at the Conference of the United Nations Framework Convention on Climate Change, which was then held in December in Lima. And it's also in a better position to enter into the negotiation this year in Paris. In the field of development, the Italian presidency set four priorities in this area: the definition of a common standing as regards the post-2015 agenda, with a view to the international negotiation which will start in New York at the beginning of this year; the underlying nexus in between migration and development. The Italian presidency tried also to underscore the very important role of the private sector in development, and on top of that also has tried to foster a reflection on the themes of food and nutrition security. As for food security, Italy has organized the second International Conference on Nutrition in Rome during the month of November 2014, which highlighted the importance of this topic and which was very useful in ensuring the participation of the European cooperation actors to the Expo 2015 in Milan. And I will conclude quoting just a few legislative acts and political initiatives that were taken during this period. We successfully worked on a wide range of legislative acts. I will just recall a few of them. In the environmental sector, we reached an agreement on the GMO regulation. In the fiscal sector, the agreement that I was briefly mentioned before to prevent the double non-taxation of the dividends and the adoption of the directive widening the mandatory automatic exchange of information among tax administration. In the framework of Justice for Growth initiative, we also managed to find an agreement on the new insolvency regulation. The Italian presidency also successfully launched a series of political initiatives aimed at strengthening the political stance of Europe with strategic partners, especially during the ASEM summit in Milan, aiming at modernizing our economy through the digital innovation and at addressing some of the most compelling issues at the heart of the European cultural heritage and values. In particular, the human rights and fundamental freedoms have been high on the six-month Italian presidency agenda. Moratorium on the death penalty, fight against organized crime, freedom of expression, respect for minorities, promotion of gender equality and women's rights, combating discrimination against the most vulnerable group are only some of the aspects of the general principle of respect for the law at European level, which is also crucial to create an environment favorable to the economic and social development. In this context, the Italian presidency reached an important agreement that allows the Council to examine and debate periodically the situation of the rule of law within the EU, legality and respect for human rights in Europe and in all member states. And I will really conclude with the final slide promoting this important event that Milan will host starting from the 1st of May till the end of October 2015, which is the Universal Expo, the Expo Milan 2015, which will be devoted to the very important topic of nutrition. Feeding the Planet, Energy for Life is the official title. And it's a series of issues that will be dealt with during this a period of several months, which will stem from the fight to the nutrition, to how to obtain a more equilibrated dietary mix in industrialized country, how to fight obesity, how to promote a type of nutrition that is based on autochthonous products, mileage zero, which is also very important here in Catalonia and in Spain, putting in value local production, establishing stricter linkages in between producers and markets and consumers, how to promote alternative energies. So a full-fledged of topics that are very important for the daily life of all the Europeans. And so we hope that a lot of people from all over the world, and namely from Spain and Catalonia, will take the chance to visit the Expo in Milan, and maybe at the same time visiting also some of the itinerary that Italy can offer. Thank you.
Bé, moltíssimes gràcies, senyor Nicoletti. Sempre hem dit que les presidències són una feinada incommensurable i jo el que admiro particularment és que el senyor Nicoletti, que com ell ha dit no hi era, no va estar a cap d'aquestes reunions, s'hagi pres la molèstia de familiaritzar-se amb aquesta feinada i amb aquest seguit de reunions. De fet, hi ha un dels enllaços al full de fets que parla de què vol dir presidir el Consell. Parla que hi ha 10 consells diferents amb una plètora de reunions molt tècniques. Doncs enhorabona, senyor Nicoletti. Li fa res que parli en català? Em pot entendre? No. Sí? Llavors, obrim les intervencions. Jo, si el senyor Nicoletti, com he dit abans, s'estima més contestar en anglès, jo ho traduiré. Si no entén la pregunta, també li traduiré. Senyor Torres.
Del Tribunal Constitucional que ha hundido la medida que pedíamos democrática. Claro, yo no sé si ustedes se han dado cuenta en la Unión Europea de que España ha entrado así un poco de refilón con una constitución que no es democrática. Si usted mira toda la constitución, la primera mitad... La primera mitad es democrática. Y la segunda sirve para anular toda la democracia que hay. Entonces aquí no se puede decir nada, no se puede hacer nada y claro, por eso digo que estoy desanimado, nada más. Muchas gracias.
Si me permite, señor cónsul general, Una cosa que tendría que decir, y tenía que haber dicho y que digo ahora, es que el señor Nicoletti es diplomático italiano, lo ha dicho él mismo. Entonces, yo lo que sugiero es que no le preguntemos cosas que él, en esa calidad de diplomático, no puede contestar. Es algo que decimos cada 6 meses cuando tenemos este debate semestral. Entonces, obviamente usted es libre de decir lo que quiera, pero no, claro. Yo ya de antemano quisiera decir que hay cosas que un diplomático de un país amigo, no es extranjero, porque somos todos Estados miembros de la Unión, y a mis estudiantes siempre les digo que el extranjero está fuera de la Unión, pero que, en fin, que es un diplomático. Entonces, ¿lo dejamos así o quiere usted decir algo? Tachete per sempre. Pues,
no, I don't think it was really a question, but rather a sharing of a feeling. I can understand the feeling, but really I cannot comment on the content of the feeling, because I would feel that is inappropriate, and anyway is out of the topic that we are discussing today.
Diu que entén el sentiment, que pot entendre, però que ell no pot comentar sobre la base, el fonament d'aquest sentiment, i que a més se surt de l'abast del tema que tenim avui damunt la taula i en aquesta sala. Una resposta molt diplomàtica, cal dir-ho. Alguna altra intervenció? Jo volia demanar-li una cosa. Jo quisiera preguntar-li algo. Si després, vostè, sí? Sí, aquest senyor.
Jo voldria, amb la línia aquesta de l'Europa dels estats, si hi ha possibilitat o veu vostè possibilitat de l'Europa de les regions, que seria l'Europa unida realment, i si veu vostè que serà necessari o creix que és necessari la Unió Europea real, que seria l'Europa de l'est con l'Europa occidental, que això nos daria realment una força internacional relevante cara a las estrategias mundiales que se están generando hoy en día, las diferentes fuerzas que están apareciendo, ¿no? Los nuevos imperios. Si Europa no necesita llegar a acuerdos ya definitivamente de una Europa realmente unida, que sea la Europa de los pueblos, donde hayan políticas comunes reales, donde realmente avancemos hacia un humanismo europeo real, no esto que ahora tenemos, que se mantiene un poco por las formas más que por el fondo. ¿Cree que es posible esto?
Well, Italy has been for quite a long time one of the countries where, if you were making an assessment of the pro-European sentiments of the people, it ranked always very high in terms of the appreciation that the normal people had of the idea of Europe, of the idea of a supranational entity. Probably this has something to do also with a certain deception of the Italian people vis-à-vis their national political parties or with the complexity of the Italian political scenery. So the Italians have always looked at Europe and at the idea of a supranational entity as a sort of an anchor which sometimes has put some constraints, but some other times has in a way helped also through this constraint the national politics and national politicians to fly a little higher than they used to do. Nowadays, this sort of a feeling within the Italian population is still there. Probably it's not as high and as unanimously pro-European as it was before, but still I believe that in comparison maybe with some other countries of the European Union, still this this sentiment and this idea of Europe as a great design, as a great design in as some of the founding fathers of the European Union have conceived Europe, founding fathers among which are some great Italian politicians, like I would like to remember people like De Gasperi or Altiero Spinelli, together with Monet, together with Schumann. I mean, I think that we would need recuperate to Europe a sort of a capacity to dream, I mean a soul. Europe sometimes has then become a place for endless negotiations, a place of fight of interest, a place of division of resources, of fight to obtain something more, of funding for certain projects, infrastructural cohesion projects or whatever. I think that if we want to go in the direction that you were suggesting, we have to make an extra effort to go to the initial ideas and the initial dreams that were part of the great vision of the founding fathers. If we are able to do that, then it will be also easier to relinquish some of the elements of the national sovereignty and to go towards a real putting together of a number of elements and prerogatives that sometimes states are defending because still Europe is also a group of national states. But I believe that quite a lot of fellow nationals, at least in Italy, would subscribe to a more ambition view of the European process for the years to come.
Bé, tant de bo no m'hagi descuidat res. Ha dit que històricament Itàlia sempre ha estat un dels estats on la població recolzava més ferventment, majoritàriament, la idea europea, la idea de la construcció d'un ens supranacional, i ha dit que potser, amb una punta d'ironia, potser això en part era una adhesió europeista deguda a la decepció amb els partits nacionals i, com ella ha dit, amb la complexitat del sistema polític italià, que em sembla un eufemisme molt reeixit. Això és un comentari personal, no ho ha dit ell. Diu que la idea aquesta de mirar cap a Europa, de mirar cap a un projecte que fa somiar, ha dit que la capacitat de somiar és molt important, que aquest fet de mirar cap a Europa ha estat també un al·licient pels polítics italians per créixer una mica, per envolar-se, no? Per volar una mica més alt, ha dit, perdó, i que el procés aquest europeista, el procés de construcció d'una estructura supranacional ha estat recolzada històricament per grans polítics italians, anomenat Alcide Di Gasperi i Altiero Spinelli, que era l'autor del primer projecte de Constitució de la Unió Europea, si volem, l'any 84, que al costat de Jean Monnet i de... Qui més ha dit? Schumann, efectivament, que era el que feia la feina i el cap, no, Schumann, doncs que al costat d'aquesta gent doncs, han contribuït molt, molt activament a la construcció d'aquest somni. Diu que cal recuperar la capacitat de somiar i que Europa ha estat darrerament escenari de divisions, de baralles, per cèntims, per calerons, bàsicament, per temes de fons de cohesió, etc etc. I d'aquesta petitesa el que cal fer per sortir d'aquest, diguem-ne, d'aquest laberint o d'aquesta nòria, el que cal fer és tornar al somni original, el somni original, que és una idea i que cal desenvolupar, que cal desenvolupar precisament perquè els que s'apleguen avui dia en el si de la Unió Europea no són, com vostè ha dit, les regions o els pobles, sinó que són estats que tenen la seva sobirania. Ho desfà, és com Penèlope. Sí.
Li toca aplicar el que els parlamentaris passen tota la vida intentant, no? Que és una Europa realment unida en tots els àmbits. El que passa, jo parlo una mica del respecte a la diversitat, que si compte això, potser es pugui aconseguir. O sigui, la Unió Europea seria un federalisme universal, una universalitat europea, jo demano, que seria el procés més lògic i més humà, no? I el que potser busquem. No? Una cosa que hi hagi un respecte a les llengües, a les cultures, a les diferents maneres d'entendre la vida, dins d'un marc comú legal, que això estaria bé. Però clar, no veig jo aquesta voluntat, sobretot des del Consell Europeu, que em sembla que treballa una mica estat per estat, no? Anem a dir, buscant no cedir poder. No? Jo busco al revés, a la inversa, crec que s'ha de cedir molt poder polític per tenir un poder social comú, un bé social comú.
És el que ha dit ell, que si aconseguim tornar a aquesta idea original, també aconseguirem que hi hagi sessions de sobirania. Qui remena les cireres són els desmembres, això és evident. Què li pareix?
Yes, no, I can share some of the views that you have put forward. Just an anecdote on that. When once our former Prime Minister Enrico Letta came here in Barcelona a few months ago to deliver a speech on the future also of the EU perspective and so on and so forth, he started quoting its personal experience and saying that when the European Council was meeting with all the prime ministers, there were in a way two different realities. One reality was the type of discussion that took place within the Council, within the room, on whatever issue was on the agenda of the European Council. There, I mean, there was everyone was in a way contributing to deal with a certain topic, obviously from the different perspective of the different heads of government. A totally different story was when then in 28 different rooms, each one of the head of state was having contact with the press of its own country and telling the story of the same European Council to its own constituency, to its own press. Because then what was a single reality, I mean, a single meeting that should have said the same thing was then multiplied by 28, because each one of the leader was telling the story, was presenting the story, was underlying some aspects of what he was able to accomplish within a certain particular meeting. And so what was only one thing then multiplied into 28 different events that had to cater to 28 different public opinion in Europe. And obviously each own the top politician had its own agenda and its own also internal agenda. This is a fact of life. I mean, the EU is something that at the same time is a common project, but is also the addition of different states with its own internal agenda, its own constituency, its own elections, and so on and so forth. What would be important is that, in a way, these 28 different realities will be able to find something in common that is more important and that has attraction that is higher than the differences that still are there in between so many different nationalities and so many member states and so many national states. Only when in this balance what is in common, what is a common project will exercise attraction that is higher than the individual short-term perspective of each and every head of state that has to win the next election in its own country will become a reality, then the European project will be able to fly high. Otherwise, it will always remain hostage of the little design of one country or the other.
Bé, ha estat un flamant, una flamant confessió europeista. Ha dit que comparteix moltes de les idees que vostè ha exposat i, per il·lustrar la dificultat de la realitat europea, ha explicat una anècdota de l'anterior primer ministre italià, o president del Consell, com li diuen allà, el senyor Enrico Letta, que va venir a Barcelona a fer un discurs. I aleshores, als marges d'aquest discurs, va explicar que quan ell assistia als Consells Europeus a Brussel·les o a les reunions de caps d'estat, hi havia dues realitats. Hi havia, d'una banda, la reunió que plegava els 28 caps d'estat i de govern que discutien de qualsevol tema que hi havia a l'ordre del dia i tots hi deien la seva, intentaven arribar a un acord i eren constructius. I després l'altra realitat era quan un cop acabat el Consell Europeu, cadascuna d'aquestes 28 delegacions, cadascuna en una cambra separada, explicava aquell mateix Consell als representants dels seus mitjans de comunicació. Llavors aquell Consell únic, amb una realitat única, es dividia, esclatia en 28 realitats diferents perquè cadascun d'aquests estats membres té la seva agenda política, té els seus objectius i ha de vendre una moto, per entendre's, cosa que tampoc és una expressió que hagi dit el senyor cònsol general, al seu públic. Llavors, això em recorda una mica, això tampoc no ho he dit d'ell, em recorda aquell llibre de Raymond Queneau, no? Exercicis d'estil, com mateix fet un incident en autobús és descrit per diferents testimonis d'aquells fets de forma totalment diferent, doncs és una mica el que passa. La realitat imita l'art, que deia Oscar Wilde, no? Doncs el Raymond Queneau ens el trobem cada cop que hi ha un Consell Europeu a Brussel·les. Llavors, el que ell es planteja és que cal que canviï perquè això deixi de ser així. I el que diu és que és un problema d'atractivitat. El projecte europeu ha d'esdevenir o tornar a esdevenir una cosa que sigui tan desitjable i tan engrescadora que les petiteses, que això sí que ho ha dit ell, la petitesa de l'horitzó estret que tinguin els diferents estats membres deixi de ser el que primi i que la gent deixi de pensar en la propera elecció municipal al seu país, sinó que s'impliquin, apostin pel projecte europeu. És a dir, bueno, és una cosa que parlem molt a la universitat, oi, Elis? Els símbols són importants i vendre és important, no és una cosa que sigui negativa i és imprescindible. Sí, vostè.
De Juncker Plan, if you consider that the 21 billion public investment will reach the target only with leverage.
That's a good question.
La pregunta era si el senyor cònsol general pensa que el pla Juncker, aquests famosos o fabulosos 350.000 milions, veritablement assoliran l'objectiu que és dinamitzar la inversió amb l'efecte palanca, dit vostè, oi? La leverage. Molt bé.
In a way, it's a sort of an act of faith, because obviously the fresh money are just a small proportion of the overall amount of 315 billion that should be the final results of this process of financial engineering. President of the Commission has been Prime Minister of State, where financial engineering obviously was one of the specialty of the country. So we all trust that he knows what he's speaking about. It's true that it's possible, stemming from an amount of money that is reduced through a system of guarantee of the European Investment Bank to obtain a final effect that is a multiplier of the amount of money that you have at your disposal at the very beginning. That is something that is done in the insurance field, that is done in project financing, that is done in various financial fields. So it is true that the 315 billions are not on the table, that the amount of real money is much lower, but it's also true that through leverage and through a system of schemes of guarantee schemes, so one can obtain a final effect that is much higher. And secondly, that the trust of the President of the Commission is that it will be a sort of a joint venture of public funding and private funding. So the real challenge would also be the capacity of mobilization of private financing that this scheme will be able to attract. It is true that the idea of this sort of Marshall Plan, that is this idea of spurring the economic growth through infrastructural projects is very important, is needed, especially during this period of economic crisis. So all of us, I think, have to hope that this plan will actually see light, and that this number of numerous initiatives that are lining up in order to be financed, because the response by the various states in order to put on the table possible projects for financing has been enormous and overwhelming, even in comparison with the 315 billions. So the demand is there, it's even much higher. One challenge will be to select projects that deserve financing, that are best than others in terms of final effects for the European context as a whole. And secondly, we have to hope that really the synergies in between public money, public institutions like the European Investment Bank and private sector will actually work.
Bé, ha dit que el Pla Juncker, aquests famosos 350.000 milions, són un acte de fe, que el senyor que ha tingut la idea, que ens ha plantejat, o que ens planteja aquest acte de fe, és un senyor que ha estat cap d'estat, cap d'un estat particularment especialitzat en enginyeria financera, que és Luxemburg, i que per tant ell, el senyor Nicoletti, confia que aquestes habilitats enginyerils les podrà esmerçar de forma productiva en aquest pla i aconseguir que els diners que hi ha damunt de la taula, que són moltíssims menys que aquests 350.000 milions, doncs amb escreix i amb la palanca que deia vostè, que és un fenomen o una tècnica absolutament habitual al món de les assegurances i la finança, esdevinguin 350.000 milions, primer repte. Segon repte, els diners que són damunt de la taula, encara que amb garanties, fent-nos servir per a donar garanties per a promoure la inversió, puguin augmentar de la quantitat que ara hi ha damunt de la taula, la idea és que hi participi el capital privat. Llavors, una de les coses que cal aconseguir és que l'acte de fe no només sigui un acte de fe europeista, sinó que sigui un acte de fe del món de les finances privat i que també posin els seus diners. I el tercer repte que ha dit, el tercer repte és gairebé paradoxal, és que en el moment en què el senyor Juncker ens ha plantejat aquest acte de fe i ha dit aplegarem tots els mitjans per aconseguir aquests 350.000 milions d'inversions, la resposta dels estats membres ha estat abassecadora i la demanda que hi ha per poder beneficiar-se del finançament d'aquest pot dels 350.000 milions excedeix amb escreix els 350.000 milions que ja hem dit que potser no hi arribem. Amb la cosa, el tercer repte és arribar a fer una selecció que no empipi ningú i que ens deixi amb els projectes més mereixedors d'una inversió d'aquest fons dels 350.000 milions. Resum, un acte de fe. Cal tenir fe, sempre ho dic. Alguna altra intervenció? Més actes de fe? Home, Europa tot s'ha fet amb actes de fe, i no deu ser pas l'únic aquest dels 350.000 milions. Jo, si em permeten, jo li preguntaria algo que me ha dejado particularmente sorprendido. Perdón, borro lo de particularmente, lo que me ha dejado sorprendido, que es que usted ha dicho que uno de los méritos de la presidencia italiana es el consenso de dejar de lado la política de austeridad presupuestaria para pasar a una orientación hacia el crecimiento. Y yo me pregunto, si yo fuera el señor Varoufakis, no soy tan guapo como el señor Varoufakis, pero si yo fuera el señor Varoufakis, ¿qué le contestaría yo a usted, habiendo oído esto? ¿Que hay realmente un consenso? ¿Hay realmente un consenso? ¿O hay un consenso amplio, pero que no abarca algún Estado miembro, cuyo nombre no quiero recordar, que no se une con particular énfasis a ese consenso?
Well, what I was trying to convey as an idea is that one of the merit of the Italian presidency has been to shift the focus. I mean, the focus that before was only on the fiscal compact rules and regulation dealing with public deficits and so on and so forth, to shift that on which are the actions that Europe should undertake in order to have an higher level of growth. Because in economic terms, obviously, without an higher level of growth, you cannot obtain results also in terms of reduction of public deficits, or you cannot obtain them with enormous sacrifices in terms of cutting public expenditure. Italy is, in that respect, is a country that is, in a way, a showcase, because probably most of the people do not know that Italy is a country that has a primary surplus since an enormous number of years. Primary surplus means that the final results, the final balance in between what the states gets in terms of taxation and what the states is spending before paying the interest of debt is actually positive. So in a situation where Italy shouldn't have to pay interest to the lenders of its enormous stock of debt, which now is around 133% of its own GDP, Italy would actually be a country which every year would put aside resources, because what is spending is much less than what is collecting from its own citizens. Notwithstanding that, notwithstanding the fact that for more than a decade Italy is having a primary surplus, which then becomes a deficit, because we have to add up to the primary surplus the paying of the interest rates on our accumulated debt. In spite of that, Italy is an economy that is substantially still is blocked in terms of growth since quite a lot of years. We have percentage of growth in between 0 and 1%, 1.5% since quite a number of years. So only with an economic growth that is higher, a government can obtain objectives of reduction of the public deficit, and in the medium long term objective of reduction of the stock of debt in a way that avoid just cutting more and more on the expenditure side. There is the centrality of the idea we have to regain impetus and focus on economic growth, because only with economic growth we will be able to make things easier in terms of be able to comply with the European rules, and only with growth we'll be able to reduce the unemployment that is the real social problem, especially the youth unemployment, especially the growing number of people that are of a lost generation of young people that are not studying anymore, that are not working, that are in this limbo of a growing number of people that are doing basically nothing within the economic system. So in order to obtain all that, the focus has to shift. This doesn't mean that Italy is preaching the idea that we have to spend more, to accumulate more debt, because we are the example that once you accumulate a certain amount of debt, then this becomes a permanent constraint on your capacity to grow. But is the idea that we have to figure out all possible instruments in order to get the economy in motion again, because only with that then we will be able also in an easier way comply with the EU norms and regulation. Obviously it's a very difficult equation, because I don't want to enter into technicalities, but with the fiscal compact it's very difficult to especially if you have a very high stock of debt, to free resources for growth. But it's an equation that has to be dealt with, because otherwise there is no future.
La culpa és meva, perquè he oblidat que el senyor Nicoletti és economista. Llavors la resposta que m'ha donat és tan diplomàtica com econòmica. Aviam, si ho entes bé, el que diu és que sí que Itàlia ha aconseguit durant la seva presidència que canviés el punt focal, ha dit, que canviés el focus del que abans, fins al primer semestre del 2014, només es mirava l'austeritat, el rigor pressupostari, que quadressin els números, i que d'ençà de la presidència italiana els estats membres de la Unió són més conscients que cal fer alguna cosa perquè hi hagi creixement. Sense creixement, cap dels problemes estructurals actuals no es poden resoldre. Llavors, d'això ha passat a explicar una mica què és el que caldria fer. Ha dit que Itàlia és un aparador, ha dit que és un botó de mostra perfecte per il·lustrar els problemes. Diu que Itàlia fa anys i panys que té un superàvit primari, que no soc economista, si ho he entès bé, el superàvit primari és la diferència positiva entre el que recapta un estat mitjançant els impostos i la despesa corrent abans de pagar el deute, abans de pagar interessos al deute. I aquesta diferència és positiva a Itàlia. És a dir, Itàlia fa molts anys despèn menys del que recapta com a impostos, però després, un cop afegits els interessos del deute, que són del 133% del producte interior brut, llavors sí que esdevé un dèficit. És a dir, que el dèficit italià, el deute italià, va creixent per la mateixa servitud d'haver de pagar el deute ja existent. I has dit que això vol dir que bàsicament no se sortirà mai d'aquest cercle viciós, que l'única manera de sortir-ne és el creixement i que per tant el que cal és cercar fórmules innovadores. Ell diu que Itàlia no està proposant d'augmentar encara més el deute per invertir i que el país creixi, però que amb el creixement que fa molts anys que té, que es mou entorn del 0, entre el 0 i l'1,5, diu que un creixement de l'1,5 no és prou potent perquè pugui crear-se feina, per exemple. No? Diu que el problema de l'atur és un problema que no es pot resoldre amb un creixement que no supera l'1,5%. Llavors cal trobar instruments consensuals que permetin que es creixi més i resoldre el problema de la generació perduda, que és la generació de joves que no fa res, que no és part del cicle productiu de cap mena, ni estudia, ni treballa, ni participa en res. Bàsicament és un jovent que no té cap mena d'esperança d'integrar l'economia productiva i que això només es pot resoldre novament creixent. Diu que, malgrat el que sembla, i malgrat algun canceller europeu, sí que els estats membres, això no ho ha dit ell, els estats membres sí que són més conscients que cal trobar, no sé si la pedra filosofal, però sí el mitjà de créixer, perquè si no això no s'acabarà mai. Bàsicament el mateix pes d'haver de servir, com es diu en francès, no sé si es dirà en llenguatge econòmic, en català, d'haver de pagar interessos del deute, bàsicament ja arrossega cap avall i elimina qualsevol efecte positiu de l'esforç que es fa. I diu que el fet de fer retallades brutals, tampoc no ha dit l'adjectiu brutal, les retallades fortes que s'han vist també a Itàlia, bàsicament l'única cosa que fan és treure encara més base perquè pugui haver-hi un creixement futur. Que doncs el camí pel que estem seguint o havíem seguit fins al primer semestre del 2014 no ens du enlloc si veritablement ens fixem només en el pressupost i en el dèficit i en reduir el deute. Lo he resumido más o menos bien?
Sí, sí. Just to be a little more concrete, for example, the idea of how to calculate in terms of the budget deficits, the type of investments that are investments, productive investments. This is something that Italy has brought to the table of the Eurogroup, and that is an important question to be dealt with, to be discussed. Because, for example, one could arrive to the certain conclusion that a certain type of productive investment could be calculated in a different terms and taken out from the calculation of the budget deficits. Another element is concerning the possibility to have at least a certain part of the stock of the overall European debt that could be put together under the umbrella of European debt in a way so to benefit of lower interests on the service of debt if compared with the national instruments of public debt that different countries are issuing. this now, I mean, today in this very moment, this seems not so important because generally speaking, the interest rate on the emission of public debt are in a lower phase. But if we think that just a few years ago, interest on the Italian public debt was something like 400 or 450 basic points over the interest rate on the German's Bund, you can understand, and the same happened for the bonus for the Spanish bonus. That means that countries that are operating with the same currency within the euro area are paying for its own debt interest rates that are completely different and asymmetrical, and that's not in a way correct because these countries are not able to devaluate and so to utilize the instruments of devaluation to spur their exports, for example, but at the same time on their debt they are paying in a totally asymmetrical way based on the confidence that the international investors are putting on the debt of Spain vis-a-vis the debt of Italy, vis-a-vis the debt of Greece, vis-a-vis the debt of Germany. Now, if we were all able to obtain and to pay what the Germans are paying for their own debt in euro, and that we have to remember that Germany arrived to have issues of debt which were not producing interest, but which were producing negative interest. So people were buying money in order to obtain at the end less money than what they invested at the very beginning. That paradoxical that then other countries which are utilizing the same currency have to pay interest rates in the range of 4 or 5% for their own debt. So the idea obviously is not possible to put in common the overall amount of debt, but if, for example, a certain percentage of this overall European debt, for example, the 60% that is the one that the treaties allows as the stock of debt that is admitted would be a European debt and so would benefit of better conditions on the financial markets, that would be obviously a release for various of the so-called peripheral states. So this, without going into technicalities, but there are various instruments and various possibilities to take advantage of the Eurozone if the different countries that are part of the Eurozone are playing as one and not playing one against the other or benefiting from the problems of the others.
Mai més no demanaré, sí. Tradueixo això molt breument, sí. I l'últimíssima, podem fer una pregunta més? Una i prou. Prou, ja prou? Prou, ho sento. Una curteta, molt bé, Elis. Vale. I després, ja després faré la resposta. Després el micròfon.
És millor que donis la resposta. Clar. En anglès o en català?
En anglès.
So how do you believe that we can use the current educational programs that the European Union has to facilitate the creation of a pan-European identity? That is in specific reference to things like, for example, the Erasmus program and that sort of thing.
Mm-hmm. Well, I think that this kind of program, starting with the Erasmus, that gives quite a lot of work, extra work to the consulates, because there are thousands of Erasmus students, Italian students, that are studying here in Barcelona, in Valencia, in various other Spanish cities. But I think that the Generation Erasmus, as it was called, is exactly a very nice example of what Europe can be in terms of being a dream. This sort of melting pot of young people coming from different countries that are experiencing life in European universities outside its own country is gives exactly the idea of what utopian Europa can be, because this kind of experience helps to open the mind of young people and obviously helps to consider Europe as an open area to consider the relation with other young people of different countries as normal, as natural, as and really creates the mentality that is needed in order to create and to obtain real European citizens for the future. So I think that these kind of programs are very helpful in terms of preparing the new generation to an higher and more utopian model of Europe.
Bé, començaré potser per aquesta segona pregunta. El senyor Palma ha demanat si el senyor cònsol, el senyor Nicoletti, pensava que els fons europeus estaven ben invertits en programes que fomentessin la identitat europea. I el senyor Nicoletti ha respost que el programa Erasmus, en particular, que ha donat lloc a grans pel·lícules, que dona molta feina al consulat, perquè hi ha molts joves italians i moltes joves italianes que venen a estudiar a Barcelona, València i altres ciutats, i doncs la càrrega de feina administrativa al consulat augmenta, però si deixant de banda aquest aspecte menor, és exactament el que cal. És el que ha dit abans en resposta a una altra pregunta, que el que cal és l'element utòpic. Cal fomentar l'element utòpic, que aquests estudiants, la generació Erasmus, que ha dit ell, és gent que considera Europa un espai obert, que considera totalment natural interactuar amb joves d'altres estats membres europeus sense preocupar-se de quin estat concret són. I aquesta idea utòpica, aquest element d'una Europa única, unida, oberta, és exactament el que cal perquè el projecte tiri endavant i per tornar a engegar el cercle virtuós que ell va dir al principi de la seva intervenció, que era el que podia superar les limitacions dels estats nacionals. I ara, si em permeten, intentaré ser molt breu i fer la traducció de la resposta a la pregunta anterior. Com a economista, ha volgut ser més concret, jo ho agraeixo, perquè les coses més concretes a mi personalment són més entenedores, parlant del tema dels dèficits. Ha dit que hi ha dos aspectes que Itàlia ha intentat promoure. Un és comptabilitzar inversions productives específiques d'una altra manera. Jo recordo això a la premsa, en va riure molt, perquè la premsa va informar que fins i tot, per exemple, el tràfic de drogues i la prostitució, segons no sé quins polítics italians, no sé si era veritat o no, o era serp d'estiu, també s'havia de comptabilitzar, però deixant de marge, llevat d'aquesta anècdota, que hi ha inversions productives que potser es podrien comptabilitzar d'una altra manera a l'hora de calcular el dèficit dels estats membres. I segon aspecte, el tan famós cas que també converteix França, dels eurobons. Diu que, evidentment, el fet que hi hagi dins d'una mateixa zona euro, és a dir, estats que tenen la mateixa moneda, que hi hagi uns costs de refinançament, és a dir, de pagar deute públic, tan asimètrics, és una cosa que no té cap sentit, perquè tots compartim la moneda euro, cap dels estats membres de la zona euro no pot devaluar, amb la qual cosa el risc real no justifica una diferència d'interessos que en el cas d'Itàlia i d'Espanya ha arribat en alguns moments a 450 punts bàsics, és a dir, que si Alemanya pagava un 1%, aquí pagàvem el 5,5%. i que aquesta asimetria de costos no té raó d'ésser i sobretot distorsiona la competència productiva i inversora de diferents estats de la zona euro. Diu que la solució seria aplegar el deute nacional, actualment nacional, perquè tothom es beneficiï dels interessos més baixos. Alemanya ha arribat a pagar o a cobrar més aviat interessos negatius, és a dir, que la gent estava disposada no només a no cobrar interessos, sinó que els hi pagava de més els alemanys perquè agafessin els seus diners i els guardessin durant 5 anys, i que ell entén que no es pot aplegar tot el deute que hi ha ara, per exemple el 133% del PIB italià i el que tenim aquí a Espanya, que ha explotat aquests darrers anys, no es pot ara europeïtzar tot aquest deute, però una cosa que ha proposat és, per exemple, dir si els criteris de convergència de la zona euro són un deute màxim del 60% del PIB, per què no apleguem en una nova categoria de deute europeu amb interessos molt més baixos aquest deute fins al 60% dels estats de la zona euro, que és a dir, que el 60% del PIB o el deute equivalent al 60% del PIB esdevindria europeu i es beneficiaria d'uns interessos més raonables i sobretot iguals per a tothom, i el que accedís d'aquest percentatge, és a dir, en el cas italià el 73%, doncs seguiria sent deute nacional amb les condicions que el mercat dictés per aquesta fracció del deute. Gràcies. Avui tindrem els sons econòmics. La culpa és meva per haver demanat el que hagi demanat. Sí.
Els
60.000 milions.
60.000 milions. Sí.
De liquidesa, sí.
Well, it will bring for sure liquidity into the system. It's a quantitative easing of a quantitative from a quantitative point of view. It's important. It's not gigantic, but it's important. So. It should be able to insert an higher level of liquidity in the system. Hopefully, will let the trickle down of money through the banking system to the enterprises in a way that is. Easier and more smoothly than what has been up until now, because it's combined with other measures that should disincentive the banks to keep their own money within the European Central Bank, and therefore it should boost the economy. It should boost also the inflation, which obviously for the individual citizens is not ideal, but from the standpoint of view of a state which is indebted, a little more inflation probably is better.
Bé, diu que ja és la raríssima Jordina promesa, però vaig a traduir. Diu que, evidentment, aquests 60.000 milions mensuals el que faran és augmentar la liquidesa del sistema. El que és clau, al seu entendre, és que, a diferència de mesures semblants anteriors, aquest cop hi ha unes mesures que les acompanyen que desincentiven els bancs a agafar aquests diners i deixar-los al Banc Central i d'afavorir, ja dic tickle down en anglès, jo diria com aspersió, no? que aquests diners arribin per aspersió mitjançant les empreses a l'economia i la faig enrotllar millor. Diu que una de les conseqüències certes d'aquesta mesura és que puja la inflació, que per a nosaltres com a ciutadans potser no sigui una bona notícia, però perquè l'economia sí que ho és, i sobretot per un estat com el nostre, que té un deute molt elevat, sempre és una bona notícia que hi hagi una mica d'inflació. I davant la inflació d'intervencions, jo ara, malauradament, haig de posar un punt final. Vull agrair a Jordina Prats, que sempre m'odia perquè ho dic això, però li vull agrair la seva presència, el seu ajut, a en Lluís Balcells, el tècnic de so també, sembla una emissora de ràdio això, i perquè sembla encara més una emissora de ràdio, sentirem ara l'himne europeu com és tradició en aquests actes. Moltes gràcies.